Hello, this is the RPG Crawler, and welcome to another product review. This time I'm checking out one that's been on my shelf for a few months now, and been on my to-do list for even longer, but I still think bears a good looking at. Now, I haven't had a lot of experience with Conan RPGs in the past, although I have casually read and enjoyed a fair amount of the original Robert Howard material. Nor have I had the opportunity to examine many other Modiphius 2D20 systems, so I will be approaching this, Modiphius' Conan Adventures in an Age Undreamed Of, from not necessarily a hardcore Robert Howard Conan fan standpoint, nor as someone with a background in other of Modiphius' numerously licensed games, but merely as an RPG gamer who happens to be a fan of old-school swords and sorcery fiction in general. The product of a 2016 Kickstarter, Modiphius' Conan Adventures in an Age Undreamed Of was released in 2017 as a PDF, and then later in that same year as a hardback hard copy. Since then, several supplements, each covering a particular type of play and most related in some way to an aspect of Conan's adventures and career, have been released. This review will cover only the core rulebook. We'll start with the technical details as always. The hard copy book is a full color cover hardback with a full color interior. The binding is excellent and includes a ribbon bookmark. It's got about 430 pages, give or take a few at the end with product advertisements, done mostly in a two-column format but liberally sprinkled throughout with artwork, the occasional table or diagram, sidebars that detail rules or cover background information on the literary setting, and the occasional full-page articles that go into discussion of the history and background of the Conan stories themselves. In fact, references to the stories are quite common throughout the book. Many of not only the chapters, but the individual sections within the chapters have quotes pulled directly from the material to illustrate the rule that they're touching on. In terms of contents, Conan is divided into some introductory material, 12 chapters that cover the rules and supplementary material, and then the book concludes with a rules reference index and a sample character sheet. The chapters include a getting started chapter, characters, skills and talents, rules, action scenes, equipment, sorcery, the Hyborian world, game mastering, encounters, and an example adventure called Vultures of Shem, and finally Heroes of the Age. And I'll go into each of them in turn. The introductory material covers some forewords from Jason Dural and Jeff Shanks, detailing their histories with the Conan universe and a bit of general history of Robert Howard's works in general, whereas the introduction actually covers the history of Howard's career and his writing with Conan in more detail, because one of the draws of Adventures in an Age Undreamed Of is its attempt to be faithful to the original material. Chapter 1, Getting Started, covers what you need to play the game, as well as the RPGs in general. I should note that Conan 2D20 requires a little bit more than the usual pen and paper RPG in terms of just material that you need on hand at the table. As far as polyhedral dice goes, Conan uses D20s and D6s, and although the specific versions of these dice for Conan have certain numbers replaced with words or with symbols, you can just use basic dice and look up the equivalents on a brief table. There's also a certain number of tokens that the game will need to keep track of the various mechanics such as momentum, fortune, and doom, which I'll get into in the chapters that discuss them. Chapter 2 covers characters, or more appropriately, character creation. Character creation in Conan 2D20 can be done either through selection off of a series of tables or through randomly rolling on said tables. Characters have 7 attributes, which can then have a few skills associated with each one. The attributes are agility, awareness, brawn, coordination, intelligence, personality, and willpower, while the skills that are tied to each attribute have their own sections. For instance, ranged weapon is tied to coordination and covers all ranged weapons, while sorcery is tied to willpower. Characters can have a series of talents as well, which are essentially traits that are picked up at each step of character creation and may offer either modifications of existing skill use or additional abilities. In each step, characters select from a menu, first their homeland, which grants a talent and their native language, and then a section that assigns certain priorities to their attributes according to a table that governs which attributes may be raised by how many points at this particular step. Characters then select a social class or caste, which grants additional talents, a skill, and then affects their story choices in the next step, which is, in fact, the story, where each cast selects a background story from options available only to that cast. Each story may offer not only the background information on what they did in their life, but an additional trait that may come up during play. Step 5 is the archetype, which works similar to classes in some games, at least in terms of defining their starting skills, talents, and gear. These may be selected regardless of social caste and include such things as archers, mercenaries, pirates, scholars, and so forth. The next step is the character's nature or certain personality that crops up from time to time, which includes attributes and improvements, additional skill modifiers, and a talent each. Step 7 is the character's educational background, which again affects skills, some equipment, and grants an additional talent. Step 8, the war story, is basically the motivating event in the character's past that helped define them and kick them on the road to adventure and further improve certain skills. Finally, Step 9 includes the ability to improve a couple of attributes and skills of the player's choice, as well as pick one general talent from pretty much anywhere. At the end of it all, you add up all of the modifications that each of these steps gave you to your character's attributes and skills, and then jot down the effects of each talent that they acquired along the way. This can result in a relatively high degree of character variation, even within the same overall archetype. Characters then figure out their resolve, their vigor, and their gold. Basically, vigor serves as a character's physical health measure, while resolve covers their mental health and endurance. Gold is basically the wealth. Now, I'll get into it more later, but Conan 2D20 treats gold as a sort of abstract. Rather than having a concrete number of specific coins, all treasure and value is abstracted down to just a generic gold value. It can fluctuate more wildly than in other systems that I've seen, and the savage nature of a lot of the setting means that certain things are far, far more expensive than in generic fantasy settings. Chapter 2 covers skills and talents, and while I'm not going to go through each one, but generally each skill has an associated attribute, a list of common uses, things that may affect the skill's difficulty on any particular use, how momentum may be spent towards improving that skill, and then a talent tree that may be selected as the skill is improved. Many skill uses are deliberately left loose and open to interpretation to allow for a certain degree of improvisation during play, although particular talents granted by a skill may unlock specific abilities and moves by themselves. There is one talent tree that is not associated with a skill but is covered here anyway, called the Fortune Talent, which may be taken when a character qualifies for them by spending experience in that matter. Chapter 4 covers the basic rules of the game, including an explanation of the dice used, then descriptions of how to use some attributes and skills. Each skill has two components, which may be developed separately over time. First is their expertise, and then there is focus. Expertise is used to represent a broad knowledge of a particular skill and is used to determine the target number for a character must roll on 2d20, with each die considered separately. A skill's focus represents the character's ability in specific instances of that skill and may grant additional successes while not improving the overall chance of any success. During a skill test, which is the more core mechanic of the entire system, a player basically rolls 2d20 with each die checked via a target number. The target number is the associated skill's attribute plus the skill's expertise number. If the die scores that number or below it, it's considered a success. If the die is low enough to be equal to or below the skill's focus number, then it is considered two successes. A particular check's difficulty is decided by the GM, but is usually represented by the number of successes necessary to fully accomplish a task. The difficulty can range fairly high, requiring characters to either score additional successes by rolling below their focus on one or both die, or scoring additional dice to roll through various means, including granting the GM things called doom points. Successes above and beyond those required by the test add to the momentum pool, which can be spent by characters on the same side during a particular encounter to produce certain effects or bonuses and are reset between action scenes. Complications may arise during a test, which essentially gives the GM ways to throw obstacles in front of the characters even if they succeed. Chapter 5 covers action scenes, which are basically either combat or other risky scenes where things can go wrong. These scenes are broken into rounds during which each character takes a turn. Unlike many other RPGs, these rounds don't have set lengths, but can be divided up in a manner appropriate to the situation at hand, which can give these rules a certain flexibility to cover things in a more narrative style and to cover different scenarios in the game, such as person-to-person combat or even ship-to-ship combat, which might use drastically different timescales. Each character can take a standard action, a minor action, and however many free actions that they want during their turn. Players automatically go first in each round, unless the GM spends a doom point for the enemies to go first, which is just one of many ways that the GM can use these doom points. I'll talk about a few more methods later on. Overall, movement and range is abstracted into various zones, rather than having fixed ranges in yards and feet. Essentially, you might have zones considered like next to a door, in the middle of a room, and then near the evil altar, and then the characters just move and attack between these blocks of zones. I actually think it's a pretty solid way to do things in a narrative style, although that may be because I've used something similar to this system for other open role-playing things that I've done. Terrain within these zones is somewhat abstracted as well, and each zone can contain various obstacles, hindrances, or hazards that may impact the characters within that zone, and then crossing terrain just requires its own specific check. Actions and attacks are divided into various types of action available each round, and usually involve some sort of skill check to accomplish. Damage is applied to a particular body part, and then reduced by the armor covering that portion of the body, and then vigor is reduced by whatever's left over. Once vigor reaches zero, then damage actually begins to inflict harm and wounds, which is when the character actually starts to take injury and suffer for it. Harm not only reduces skills, but whereas vigor recovers between action scenes, harm requires longer-term treatment to heal up. So it is pretty vital that characters keep that quickly replenishing vigor pool up to a necessary standard and know when to back off. A similar system covers mental damage and stress. Effectively, a character can be driven mad or shocked into inaction or even absolute catatonia depending on the severity of the stress. And I kind of really like that combination of both physical and mental threats that the system can represent. The rest of Chapter 5 covers various other necessary rules that you might find in an action scene, anything from mounted combat and movement to other non-combat actions. Chapter 6 covers equipment, and this is where the abstract gold unit is explained in more detail, but it's also where this idea is introduced that items are not instantly available everywhere. Some require a test to even find, depending on the nature of the item and the settlement in question. You'd be hard-pressed to find full armor or major constructions in a wild barbarian settlement, for instance. Encumbrance is also abstracted out, with each item having an encumbrance rating rather than a specific weight. Characters can simply carry up to a certain number of encumbrance before beginning to incur additional fatigue between scenes. A broad variety of items are listed under equipment, including buildings, some of which can apply adjustments to character skill use. Weapons and armor bear a special mention, since weapons have a certain reach in damage, and reach is dealt with in terms of how many zones that particular weapon can cross, but also additional qualities that serve as traits. And these traits are actually, while they're fixed to each weapon, when you deal with magic weapons later on, what few magic weapons may appear in the game, they're simply done by adding an additional trait to a weapon that may not already have it. These traits may incur special effects when the weapons are used, such as weapons that set people on fire, mostly used for things like alchemist fire, things like that. Armor likewise has some special qualities, although in the armor's case, these traits mostly present penalties. And I use the non-standard like magic item or whatever thing sparingly in terms of describing this, because Conan is not really known for having a lot of magic items. What magic items are there are usually pretty limited in scope, and that's reflected in the system. Chapter 7, in fact, touches on sorcery, which in the world of Conan can be very dangerous and an unpredictable thing. In fact, it shares many things in common with the Lovecraftian mythos. Sorcery covers not only large-scale rituals and spells, but also petty enchantments, which can be simple alchemical compounds that produce what might be otherwise mundane effects. Sorcery itself continues the sorcery talent tree from the skill section onward into a more advanced talent tree, which can impact the various types and flavors of spells that are used. Each spell has a number of different effects and variations, meaning that one type of spell can represent what might be considered multiple discrete spells in other systems, each one with its own momentum required and difficulty to cast. This makes for a slightly more adaptable system, but one which can be a little bit more difficult to understand at first. Chapter 8 is an in-depth examination of the Hyborian world at large, covering the various geography and cultures therein, and includes a number of sidebars referencing the original literary material. It can be invaluable for someone who isn't extremely familiar with the source world or only has a casual understanding of it. Game mastering is covered in Chapter 9, which covers all of the various rules and ideas that players don't need to know. This includes guidelines for setting up scenes and dealing with skill tests, adjusting the scene based on suboptimal skill tests in case you want to continue moving forward even at the face of failure, how to handle momentum, and information on spending doom, a mechanic that allows characters to trade various resources and gain advantages in return for the GM having something to activate later on, including activating certain monster abilities, increasing the threat range, adding reinforcements to encounter, or engaging in other activities. It's actually kind of an interesting mechanic that's inherited from another game that the 2D20 system was actually designed for, but I'm not certain if it actually fits the Conan universe thematically. Fortune points are also discussed, which are various ways that players can trade a limited resource for a temporary gain, basically just by testing their luck, and then various qualities common to Conan adventurers in general are examined, as well as ideas that are useful to keep parties together. There is sort of a downtime and upkeep mechanic for use between adventures as well, which kind of abstracts downtime and carousing to allow for more focus on action, which is an approach I actually like when you consider the source material, which didn't spend a lot of time on examining Conan's micromanagement between his various action sections. There's also talk about experience and increasing skills and talents. Rather than having a level-based system, experience is just used to purchase additional expertise, focus, attributes, and talents. Chapter 10 is a basic bestiary covering various threats and creatures that you come across during encounters. These are broken into a few tiers: minions for weak mook types, toughened for challenging enemies that can be a force on their own, and then nemesis for those boss-style creatures. Some creature types may appear in different tiers, and there are specific rules for attacking entire groups of creatures that helps to cut down on micromanaging the position and movements of many different types of creatures. For instance, when you engage an entire horde of cultists, you can treat many of them as just clump them up into individual groups of creatures that are treated as basically one creature. Each creature type has 7 attributes, fields of expertise that serve as abstractions of the skill list into a more manageable list for the creatures, how much stress and other damage that they can soak up, a list of attacks, and special abilities that can be activated via momentum or doom. The creatures cover a range from basic humans and animals to strange creatures of Lovecraftian influence. It also includes a number of major NPCs drawn directly from Howard's stories. Chapter 11 is a sample adventure called The Vultures of Shem that can be used by a GM directly, or at the very least gives a very solid example of how to set up a basic Conan 2D20 adventure. Chapter 12 covers Heroes of the Age, which is stats for Conan-themed NPCs that were contributed by Kickstarters of the project and statted out according to the same details that are listed in Chapter 10. These are of varying quality, but a number of them are actually quite interesting and thematically appropriate. The book concludes with a basic reference tables and legal information, as well as a list of Kickstarter backers. So what do I think about Adventures in an Age Undreamed Of? Well, again, I'm not big on the prior Conan RPGs, so I have nothing to compare it to in that regard. So looking at it on its own, there's just two things to consider. First is as a representation of an RPG system itself. Second is its treatment of Robert Howard's source materials. So let's look at the system first. To start with, I can appreciate that it's got a focus on action and narrative flexibility. It seems designed for quick, heroic combat and dangerous events, and it seems to do that quite well. I appreciate the abstractions where they appear, as it can help minimize the need for battle maps and helps to cut down on general bookkeeping. I also find that I very much enjoy the diversity of character options that are available and how different the various character builds can be, even within the same archetypes. As well as the course of incremental advancement that can be taken during long-term play due to the experience advancement system. However, the 2D20 system itself was clearly designed for another property in another genre entirely, and some elements of that can still poke through from time to time. The Doom system has been criticized by others as not fitting the Conan universe, and I am inclined to agree with that evaluation, although I find it more broadly acceptable simply because I'm also a fan of other sword and sorcery traditions, several of whom included some sort of cosmic balance or cosmic duality that can explain that sort of mechanic. Furthermore, the Doom and Momentum systems can result in some issues when dealing with players who aren't exactly team players, resulting in the whole party potentially being punished for the irresponsible use of these mechanics by just one person. This may take some very careful action on the GM's part to address. Going forward, the ranged attack system was difficult for me to grasp at first, as it seems to include some adaptations that attempted to adjust from a full auto-style modern ranged firearm system all the way back to bows and arrows and thrown weapons that doesn't exactly translate well in some instances. Now, I'm not entirely convinced about how well-received long-term games that span multiple adventures might be either, simply because there's certainly rules for linking such adventures, but the inconsistency of progress between adventures may not appeal to players who appreciate a more regular accrual of character resources. It seems to more ride a boom and bust cycle to keep characters adventuring. Then there's the adaptations of the material itself that one must look at, and this can be a bit of an issue depending on who you talk to. The original material was written back in the 30s, and as such has certain things that certain sections of the modern audience can find that they have issues with. I feel that Conan 2D20 addresses the source material in a respectful and decent manner, doing much to present everything that you need to portray the Hyborian Age in a manner consistent with the original source material while still being fun for as many people as possible. I understand that some individuals may find this material watered down as a result, and still others are still going to have issues with it no matter what happens to it. I, for one, feel that a good balance was struck, as I said, and that enough of the framework was given to add in whatever you feel lacking if you're one of those that feels that it watered the source material down. I do appreciate the team focused more on the original literature rather than the zillions of other post-Howardian adaptations that have arisen through the years, from comic books, movies, and so on, because once again, it gives a solid base upon which a good GM can add their particular source material to. I always enjoy modularity in that regard, and as it enables each game that's run to feel a little bit different. In terms of the artwork and writing, as I said before, I had some minor confusion sometimes when looking up certain rules. The writing is mostly concise and to the point, but it indicates that it could use some more thorough explanation in certain instances to be, you know, just better presented. And some of the material pretty much assumes that you read through the entire book and then go back to a prior point in order to fully understand it. The artwork, however, is excellent, being taken from a number of classic Conan artists and really lending itself to the feel of high adventure in a primitive age, and I think it goes a long way towards giving this product the sort of value that it has. Overall, I believe that Modiphius' Conan, Adventures in an Age Undreamed Of, is an excellent presentation of the material tied to a somewhat suboptimal system, but one which does its part in focusing on action and quick-paced scenes well enough to make up for its flaws all in all. And the complexity of its interlocking resource systems is a system that you're going to have to just get used to. It did it well enough, in fact, that I'm actually interested in both picking up more Conan 2D20 supplements and perhaps checking out other Modiphius products, although I'll admit, even with the broad array of licenses that Modiphius has picked up over the past few years, only a very few appeal to me. That having been said, I'm still not convinced over whether 2D20 system in general is as viable a multi-genre system as they're trying to make it. I'll have to see other 2D20 games to see if that's the case. Anyway, I'm going to leave it at that. This has been the RPG Crawler with my review of Conan, Adventures in an Age I've Dreamed Of. As always, I'll put a link to where you can pick it up in the description below. If you like what you've seen, remember to leave a like, comment if you've got any feedback, and subscribe for more RPG content, both tabletop and computer. Until next time, take care and goodbye.